amongst the Gedolim today, if I would have to give you names of who accepted the concept of what I call cardiac and respiratory death and needing both of them. So for those who want to write down the names, I'm going to give you the names, but you should realize the category of people that we're dealing with. Bear with me a second.
Before you do, Rabbi, it's yeah. impossible because I really don't think, and again, I told you, Rabbi, Rappaport wouldn't be here. I don't feel that the other camp, their position was represented on the three sources that you just brought, both in the Talmud, both in the Chacham Sofer, and the Chacham Tzvi. And with your permission, and with permission of the audience, I would like to tell the audience what the other camp would have said in those three
sources. You want me to say? You want me to tell you what you want to tell me?
Well, I think you kind of alluded to them, but I don't think they actually were
addressed. Okay. I will get back to very shortly. I just want to give the names, and then we'll go back to that. No problem. When it comes to those who accepted cardiac respiratory death, so you have the following Gedolim that we know today who accepted the Chasam Sofer literally without any type of manipulation. You have Rav Elazar Shach. You have Rav Yitzchak Yaakov Weiss, who's the head of the Minchas Yitzchak. Of Yitzhak Kulis, the Shifra by Yerushalayim, of Rav Lezer Waldenberg, the Tzitz Eliezer. You have Rav Nissen Karlis, the Shifra by of Ramat Aaron at that time. Rav Tzviya, Rav Shmuel HaLevi Vazner, who wrote Shevet HaLevi. You have Rav Nason Gestetten, the author of the Tshuvas Maris Nathan. Okay. I'll just show you something, then we'll go back to deal with the other issue. You have also, when it comes to the ones who held this specific sheet, just bear with me a second. You have Rav Hutner Zatzal. You have Rav Yaakov Kamenetsky Zatzal. When it comes to Rav Soloveitchik's opinion, I just want to read you the following. And this is quoted by Rav Binyamin Wellfish, who at that time was the head of the RCA, and he had many talks with the Rav when it comes to brain death definition. So he said the following. I want you to know that Rabbi Joseph E. Soloveitchik is numbered amongst those authorities who did not endorse neurological criteria of death. And he says that Rav Soloveitchik says he did not accept brain death interpretation. As far as he's concerned, this itself was known amongst the members of the family. And also his Talmidim, like Rav Aaron Kahn, Rav Menachem Grack, Rav Herschel Schechter, all of his Talmidim had spoken to the Rav. The Rav did not accept brain death as interpretation. This also was supported by Israel Tversky, who is the Rav's son-in-law, who was one of the major professors in Harvard University, that the Rav did not accept brain death criteria. Also, Rav Shlomo Zalman Arbach, Rav Eliashiv, I can go down the list. So it seems that despite what was going on, they basically did not accept it. Now, the question is, how did the other camp learn the Gemara, which is basically what you're concerned with? When it comes to how the respiration or the brain death camp learned the Gemara, what's quite obvious to me, and this I've asked the question when I debated Rabbi Tenler on the topic many times, is that if you read the Gemara literally, I can see where you're coming from. The Gemara itself, I see without Rashi, the Yavam Machlokes, when you check the heart and the lungs, and the debate is, which is the Ikar Chiyus? Once you introduce Rashi into the sources, and the Chacham Tzvi, there's no way on the face of the earth that I can see anybody saying that that could be attributed to the brainstem neurological camp. The Gemara literally can. Once you bring Rashi and the Chacham Tzvi and the Chasam Sof into the picture, I find it quite difficult. Now, what I do want to mention is that going back to brain death, there are two versions of brain death. One is respiratory death, which is basically what Dr. Abram Steinberg advocates, and you have what's called of physiological death, which is what Rabbi Dr. Tenler advocates. Let me explain to you how each one came into their opinion. There's no question that Dr. Steinberg took this Gemara literally, that we checked the nose, we checked the heart, as a debate, and I heard, because I heard the initial debate, the initial lecture he gave many, many years ago at the AOJS, when he presented his position, he took the Gemara actually literally, as therefore the debate being the major philosophical, theological question whether the Mishkan and Nefesh is in the brain, the Mishkan and Nefesh is in the heart. And by the fact that Gemara seems to say you check the nose at the end indicates that the brain camp or the respiratory camp went out, and that basically shows you that if they're no longer respiring, it means the brain has become dysfunctional. Therefore, if the brain is dysfunctional, the neshama contained in the brain must have undergone yitzias and neshama. That's how he came to his basic conclusion. Dr. Tenler's conclusion is based upon a different conclusion. He uses the source that I have, that I alluded to before in my morning presentation on page number 6, and that is the Mishnah in the Sefer Olos that talks about decapitation. Over there, the Mishnah says very explicitly, a person, a human being, who has a major part of his head damaged with his connection to the body, is still considered alive if he's still functional. However, the Mishnah says, when it comes to animals, and perhaps when it comes to human beings, Huchu Rasheim, once you decapitate them, even though you see some type of muscular movement after the decapitation, like you cut off a head of a lizard and the tail still moves, the animal or the person is considered dead. This is called physical decapitation, death. Nobody on the face of the earth, in the world of Halakha, will question this. This is a Mishnah, part of Torah Shvatah. Physical decapitation is death. Whichever way you want to turn it, it's death. I will mention to you, and this you have to be aware of, for intellectual honesty, I have to be intellectually honest on all sides, that not everybody says, where it says Huchir Hashem, that decapitation is considered death. Not everybody from the Rishonim and the Mishnah say this applies to human beings. There is a Shitas Harash, Shitas Harashiv, Shitas Atosis who claims Huchir Hashem, decapitation makes death for animals, but it doesn't apply to human death. There is such an opinion. There's no question about it. And for intellectual honesty, we have to mention that opinion. But at the end of the day, the poskim who deal with brain death are relying upon those Rishonim who learned the Mishnah, that there's no differentiation between animal death and human death. When you knock off the head, the person is dead, lock, stock, and barrel. And as I mentioned in my morning's presentation, when you knock off the head, when you decapitate, you have a total destruction not only of the brain tissue, but of all the other organs that are leading up to the brain, including the major blood organs and everything else, all the connective tissue is severed, there's nothing more to talk about. In that case, there's no question that Rav Moshe says when you have a total physical decapitation, ein lo keshem a guf klal, the brain no longer has a connection with the body, and therefore near kav legamri, that you have total deterioration or total destruction of the brain cells, that is a biological reality nobody can debate. That doesn't mean we don't have in historical literature people undergoing the death of the guillotine and then walking on the stage after their heads are decapitated and the executioner having a heart attack. That's called the Lazarus reflex, where we have a possibility that the person's nervous system, which works automatically independent of the brain, can cause the person to have reflexes to sit up or to walk, even though their head's no longer connected. That's not considered an indication of life and death, and that's similar to the movement of the tail of the lizard once it's been severed from the head. We have that in medical literature. But one thing is for sure, that those who learn the mission as being the source of death say the Huchir Hashem applies to not only animals, it applies to human beings, and they hold like those Rishonim who learned the Mishnah that way.